Welcome to Subramani. Continuing with the John Templeton rules, we saw there 16 in number. Now we'll come to 11, 12, 13. The 11th one is learn from your mistakes. The most important learning from the history of man's mistakes is that we do not learn from our mistakes unless we make a special attempt to do so. Now, there is a very old habit of something called maintaining a diary. Now, when you maintain a diary, what happens is you write down a lot of things which you did, which obviously will include your mistakes. Later on, when you read, you realize, oh, I made this mistake, and there is possibility of some learning. However, if you do not write down your mistakes, if you do not write down why you made that mistake or what caused that mistake, was it some emotional upheaval because of which you made that mistake, or because you took something for granted, or you assumed certain things, you will never know why you made those mistakes. And if you do not make an attempt to learn from the mistakes, you will not learn from the mistakes. So, later on in life, we realize that, this was my biggest mistake, and this mistake was big but did not cost me much, you know, for whatever reasons, right? So, some of those things you learn only when you introspect, or you start writing down all that you do, which will include your mistakes also, so that later on when you're reviewing what you've done or what should have happened and why there is a gap, you know what are the mistakes you made. Of course, one big mistake which people make is of course not even coming to these 16 rules, because they do not invest at all. Not investing is also a very big mistake, because it means you will never have enough money, because your money has not grown at a rate faster than inflation. And mistakes of omission and mistake of commission, both would be there. It is not just what you do which hurts you, it is also what which you do not do which hurts you. Somebody comes and tells you, suppose somebody came and told your dad or somebody in 1980, why don't you buy some equity share? He says, no, I recoil the horror of what could happen to my money. Of course, there was a chance that you could have lost money. There is a chance that you could have made tons of money, right? If you had bought Wipro, you would have a few hundred crores. If you had bought Silverline, you would have lost that money. But the cost of not investing in the index for, say, 100 rupees, what was available, and today what is about 38,000 rupees is 380 times appreciation of your capital over a 40-year period. Not bad at all, right? So those are the things that you learn. And if you are an investor, maintaining a book to write down what you are doing is very useful, because of the mistakes that you make, and you will write down about those mistakes too. Let's come to number 12 is do not be fearful or negative too often. We will always go through painful moments in our lives. So during those times, it is important that you should not be too negative. Take the case of coronavirus. People are assuming that it is the end of the world. It is not the end of the world. Yes, of course, it's going to be very difficult. People at the bottom of the pyramid are going to suffer more, but that's always true in every crisis. But this is one of those rare crises which is affecting 140 countries. Lives have been lost in every country, right? The US has lost more lives than it lost in the Vietnam War, and I only hope it does not reach the World War figures of lives lost, but it is huge. 100,000 was considered to be the limit. Now it is about 150,000 lives are being lost. That's not small by any stretch of imagination, right? So, of course, there is a crisis. Of course, there is a problem. Of course, there is unemployment. But at the same time, there would be some companies which are sounding very morbid, but they're benefiting. Like your Google is a big beneficiary. Facebook is a big beneficiary. Flipkart or Amazon are a big beneficiary. Netflix is a big beneficiary. Zoom is a big beneficiary, right? So many of these companies are also very big beneficiaries because of the coronavirus in terms of look at the business is booming. So of course the downside is much much bigger than the upside, but having had a problem, you have to find out how to come out of it instead of sitting and brooding over it and wallowing in self-pity. You can't do that. You have to come out of it. It is far more fashionable and bankable to be negative and fearful than sound cheerful and happy, right? Switch on the television and every program is telling you why the world is about to come to an end, but the world doesn't come to an end. Take the case of people complaining about secularism in India. How many times have we declared that from 2014 till now we have declared socialism, secularism dead in India every 3 months, every 4 months. The latest was of course on 5th of August when people said, oh, this is the end of secularism. But secularism in India doesn't die so often, but so you have to be careful. Look at people who have said, oh, India is finished. And how many people who have said India will not grow? How many people who said the Imperial College study, Imperial College of UK, said millions of Indians will die. By now, so many millions should have died, but our numbers are in control, right? Even the earlier decades when investors made money, the news flow was not all, was always negative. So be careful about negative news flow. Come above it. Make sure you don't succumb to it, because once you succumb to negative news, you never know how badly it can take a toll on your mind and your body. As national economies become more integrated and more independent, as communication becomes easier and cheaper, business is definitely booming, but the bad news can also spread just as fast, right? So just below this, I'll give you a link to what I had written. I'm reading out from portions of that, and I'm also saying that wealth will increase when by the time we reach 2027. It is not just around, which is just around the corner. There will be an even chance that the Sensex would have crossed 45,000-50,000 points, right? So today we are at 38. Chances are that certain other indices would have grown more, but this the main Sensex would also be nudging 50, if not 50. Okay, now. I don't think nothing much is going to change. I hope to be around to see the index at 50,000. Why 50,000? I hope to be around to see the index at 100,000 also. So that was point number 12. Let's come to point number 13. Yeah, number 13 is very easy. Outperforming the market is a difficult task. Outperforming the market is really a difficult task. You can outperform some fund managers, but outperforming the market continuously is not going to be very easy. So, and far more importantly, there is absolutely no reason to outperform the market, because you are in it for yourself. You are in it to fulfill your goals. So whatever you do, if you are able to fulfill your goals, then life is quite fine. You need not break any. You need not create alpha, you need not follow any benchmark. That is for fund managers. Fund managers, when they have 50,000 crores and 100,000 crores, they need to have some criteria, right, for their own bonus, for their own growth, for comparing themselves with the fellow fund manager. Like they said in Animal Farm, all managers are equal, but some managers are more equal. That's all. So for them it is a comparing tool. You don't need to, because if you go and tell your spouse or your children, I outperformed the Sensex, they're going to say, what does it mean? Can we meet our goals? Do we have enough protection? Those are the questions that the family needs to know. The getting of alpha or not getting of alpha is a pure ego kick for the fund manager. The end investor should not even bother about seeing the benchmark related performance. If it's there, it's there. Far more important is, are you able to meet your goals? And do you have adequate risk cover just in case something goes wrong? These are the only two questions to answer. Thank you.